Good afternoon. Ethan Allen here on ThinkTech Hawaii. Thanks for joining us here on Life Above Science. We are back here on a lovely Friday afternoon talking about how science relates to everyone's lives, why people should care about science, why we all should embrace science and think of it in very positive and uplifting terms rather than regarding it as this strange foreign stuff that happens only in deep dark laboratories done by strange weird people like scientists. And today I have a strange, weird scientist with me, but she actually does science in a really exciting environment. She does science in the deep blue sea. And Sonia Rowley, she's a postdoc at UH Manoa in geophysics and geography?
Geology and geophysics.
Yeah. And also is the chief science officer for the Association for Marine Exploration, which sounds like a lot of fun.
It is, very much so. It's a non-profit that I'm involved with some very eminent scientists, and we go off and we discover realms that people don't typically go to.
Right. Yeah, I had a year ago on the show, I think one of your graduate students, Josh Copus, right, and he talked about the mesophytic zone.
Mesophytic zone.
Yeah, right, okay, mesophytic zone, right, the sort of the mid-light zone where it's not quite pitch black, but certainly not as bright as the surface. And you go down towards that region, right?
We go in there. The NOAA governmental, they called it the mesophotic zone because people didn't know what to call it for a very long time. And it was called the twilight zone
a bizarre connotation in this country with those very famous television shows.
Yes, and all that kind of stuff. And so I quite often call it twilight reefs because it's still kind of twilight and it trips off the tongue a little better than mesophotic.
So tell me, I mean, this seems like sort of an odd thing for you to get into, particularly because you're from Britain originally, when I can't envision people do too much scuba diving around Britain. How did you get started in this?
Well, my parents started when I was 3 years old diving, and I've been diving myself for 32 years now. I didn't start when I was three, but they started there, and then over the years they bought a 67-foot diving vessel, and I spent a large part of my diving life early years and stuff on that, and I had my first dive in the Summer Isles. You don't do temperature when you're younger. I'm sure of it. I mean, now I'm just like, oh. but it was really, really good. And it's different. People think, oh, it must be, awful. And no, absolutely not. It's absolutely brilliant. There's lots of biodiversity, loads of things to see. It's different. It's just very different. You don't see coral reefs as one would see, in the tropical region.
I mean, it's different just as a temperate forest is different from a tropical forest.
Quite.
Same kind of thing. Different species and all of it, but both have lots of richness, lots of interesting stuff to see.
Yes.
And as you dig deeper into them, you keep finding more and more stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, my father's an engineer, and so we were all about hunting wrecks. So that was the main thing. For many, many years, I always wanted to sort of combine the diving science, diving technology, with marine biology. I just wanted to know what everything was and what it did.
That's right, because I saw some stuff on your website that you guys do some technology developments and try to promote some of the cutting-edge diving technologies and things.
Yes, we're test pilots for Poseidon and Cislunar technology. And very, very cutting-edge rebreather technology and breathing systems.
Right, and that's got to be very important for the work you do in it, because if you go that deep, you can't rely on standard scuba, right?
We use rebreathers. It's a much more efficient way of actually extending your bottom time when you're actually down under the water. So the difference, really, I think the easiest way to put it without getting too technical is, so with open circuit scuba, when you breathe out, you see bubbles.
Right.
And with closed circuit rebreather technology, essentially your exhalant is going back into what we call counter lungs and then into a scrubber series of chemicals that actually take out the carbon dioxide, that 4%. Right. And then we have electronics that fine-tune how much oxygen and what other gas mixes go back into our inhalant. So we're recycling, because essentially it's about 16% oxygen is our exhalant. And if that's just going off into the water column, then that's a waste, right?
Right.
So we're rebreathing it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so we don't take big hoofing tanks down, although we do have bailout tanks attached to us. So if anything goes wrong, then we go off into open circuit attached.
Yeah. No, and that's actually a very all the parallel technologies evolving for water usage. Now there are actually systems evolving where people can set up apartments that have their own fixed water system. And people just reuse the water all the time.
Yeah.
It's the same water, and they keep scrubbing it and reusing it, scrub it and reuse it. And,
yes, yeah. So same idea. Very efficient.
But so that makes your background, makes it clear how you got into the whole diving thing, but you also have obviously an educational background that got you into the science end of it.
Yeah.
And can you tell me a little bit about that?
Right, well, for those younger viewers amongst us, I was not a good student. really. And I didn't actually decide to go into education until I was 30 years old. I went off and did all sorts of things, lots of diving and various other bits and bobs. I guess one day I had an epiphanous moment and I was like, good for goodness sake, this is what you've always wanted to do. And I went and did an access course in the University of Plymouth in England. Uh-huh. And then I did a marine biology bachelor's degree. And then I got my PhD in New Zealand at the University of Wellington, Victoria. None of it was my plan. However, it's all worked out really, really well. But as I said, you know, when I was younger, I always wanted to know what everything did and what it was. And this is not like a self-pity flag at all. I'm dyslexic, so I didn't feel that I could go into any form of higher academia of any level. So it was only until later on, after I achieved other things in my life, that it was like, oh goodness, I can do this. You know, but I had to come to that point. And now it's great because you just kind of think out the box a lot more, and I love to combine the two. Mm-hmm. So my primary area of research in terms of biology is I'm fascinated by mechanisms of evolution, how things have evolved and diverged and come to adapt to these environments over geological time and evolutionary time.
And the corals are a particularly nice group to look at for that because, for one, they're long-lived, they're stable, they fossilize well, right? I mean, they've got a lot of good stuff for looking at evolution, and living in the deep sea, they're relatively relatively stable, right?
Yes, I mean, so...
Long-term trends.
Yes. Yeah. So the group that I tend to work, I do work on, I focus on, are called Gorgonians.
Right, and that's what a Gorgonian is. That's a term which most of our audience probably doesn't really know.
Yeah, so Gorgonians, or more commonly called sea fan corals.
Okay.
That's because most of them are shaped like a sea fan.
Very flat.
Planular, yeah. I mean, they have all sorts of other interesting morphologies, and I think I have a figure just to show about that. And you can get them from the shallow water all the way down to the deep ocean.
Uh-huh.
And they change. So the ones at the deep ocean at the bottom of that figure, you will see it's very spiral. This is called Iridogorgia spiralis. It's absolutely gorgeous. I mean, just look at it. It's absolutely... And there's all sorts of crazy shapes and sizes. And the reason why it's this shape may be due to be able to maximize nutrient capture in the water column. Because you're like you say, you're in a benign environment, but you do get strong ongoing water currents.
Mm-hmm.
Also, as you kind of, I wanted to show this kind of bathymetric, this depth thing here, and temperature, rough. Sorry, it's in centigrade. I should have put it in Fahrenheit.
good for our audience.
yes, a little bit of education. I've got it in meters, which is in feet. Okay, I'll try and extrapolate. But this is part of this slide is something that my friend and colleague Richard Parr uses, and it shows a little bit. So most people know about the shallow waters up to around 30, 40 meters, 100, 120 feet, something like that. And that's usually around plus or minus 3 degrees, around 30 degrees centigrade, 75 degrees Fahrenheit, 75 to 80. Around the Indo-Pacific, and it's actually circumtropic, you will find lots of big sea fans. In fact, Hawaii is one of the few exceptions to this rule. We have like one sea fan coral, and it's like this, it's tiny, it's this big. And it's Acarbaria bicolor, it's absolutely gorgeous. But Hawaii is like many island communities. Because it's so isolated, it provides a fantastic opportunity for various evolutionary mechanisms and curiosities to come about. Then as you go deeper, then you start to get a different, you get like a faunal shift in a way. And some species actually span great depths, and most of them, not all of them, but most of them don't have zooxanthellae. Now, zooxanthellae are the little symbiodinium, the single-celled algae that you'll see in your hard corals, the reef-building corals that people talk about.
So you're saying these Gorgonian corals don't have those?
Most of them don't. A lot of them do, but a lot of them do, but most of them actually don't.
Like the deeper living ones?
Yes.
Okay, it makes sense, because these zooxanthellae you want light, basically.
Exactly. So. I have worked on zooxanthellate ones, and I can talk about that in a second, but the azooxanthellate ones, as you start to go deeper, and this really hit home to me when I was actually doing my PhD in Indonesia, is as you start to go deeper, the level of abundance and diversity just explodes. And with the diving technology that I use, it's insane. It's like fields. I mean, whenever we drop down deep, I don't have to travel too far. I've got everything I need in front of me. It's just like, oh my God, that's new. This is it. This is it. You know, it's fabulous. You know, I'm like a kid in a sweet shop. And so every time we go down to these deeper depths, now that technology is allowing us to do so, this is where we really are finding new species to science, new interactions, interesting ecology, interesting patterns. And of course, there's differences between continental regions and islands.
Mm-hmm, right.
To conceptualize it for the audience, so Gorgonian sea fans, people are familiar with corallium. So that's the precious red corals here that people make jewelry out of.
Sure.
They are a Gorgonian.
Oh, okay.
And the reason why they're called Gorgonians is they have a protonaceous structure, and it's made from Gorgonin. There we go. And that's one of the reasons. There's all sorts of mythical stuff in there as well.
Okay.
But those are
the thought it was the Greek Gorgons, the monsters.
Sounds terrible, doesn't it? No, they're not monstrous.
But that's fascinating what you say, that the biodiversity increases at depth. You tend to think of at least the great depths as being sort of almost deserts, in a sense of having very sparse life, being areas where creatures have to forage very broadly to find others of their own kind or food or whatever, but these mid-depths, you're saying, are actually a whole rich biome.
Yes, the twilight zone or mesophotic zone, it's very much, it's hugely diverse and abundant, really it is.
But we just don't know about it because until recently, no one's ever really seen it.
Quite, because if you used a submarine, for example, they can be like $39,000 or more or less, plus or minus something rather, to raise funds to use that for one dive.
Right.
Okay? So if you're going to do that, you're not really going to start pottering around in what you consider the shallows. If this thing has a 2,000-meter capability, then you want to go as far as you can.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, and that's where you start to see these wonderful curiosities, like the Iridogorgia spiralis that I showed you earlier, and all sorts of interesting stuff. And the age of these creatures are amazing.
They live for long periods, you're saying?
Hundreds of years sometimes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
That's very, very, very neat. So how does this change, since we know the oceans are beginning to warm, what are the impacts going to be on this coral? Do you have any sense of that? I mean, our surface coral we're having right now, some very bad bleaching events on our shallow water corals.
Mm-hmm.
Are your deeper Gorgonians affected by this at all?
Well, this brings up two things. One of the things is that Gorgonians seem to be able to survive a little better. And this may be due to a number of things, but one of the things that one needs to be aware of is they're actually older in the geological record. And as a group, octocorallia, so that's a big, word. Okay, so one of the key differences between, say, like a sea fan coral, Gorgonian coral, and the corals that you see on the reef around Hawaii and all the other areas, is very simply, octocorals, Gorgonians, have 8 tentacles. And your hard corals that you see on the reefs have 6 or multiples of 6.
Oh.
So that's bottom line, main thing, start of the 10.
Okay.
And then, of course, the ones that you see on the reefs, you know, the scleractinians, the hard corals, they have that exoskeleton, that external skeleton that they make the reefs, that form the basis of all this beautiful structure.
And the Gorgonians don't, but...
No, they don't.
So we're gonna look into this more deeply, but we're going to have to take a short break first before we really dig into the evolution here of the corals.
Right.
So you'll be, I hope, back after our little break here. Dr. Sonia Rowley from UH and the Association for Marine Exploration is with me here today in the ThinkTech studios. Likeable Science will be back after a short break.
I'm Jay Fidel, and I'm the host of Research in Manoa, Mondays from 12 to 1 on thinktechhawaii.com. Take a look at us and learn about geophysics, learn about planetology, learn about the ocean and earth sciences at UH Manoa. You'll really enjoy it. So come around. We'll see you then.
Aloha, this is Maria Mera, and I'm here to invite you to my bilingual show, Viva Hawaii on ThinkTech Hawaii, every other Monday at 3 p.m. We're here to inform, motivate, and entertain you. Join us. Hola, soy María Mera y estoy aquí para invitaros a mi show bilingüe Viva Hawaii en ThinkTech Hawaii cada dos lunes a las 3 de la tarde. Estamos aquí para informaros, motivaros y entreteneros. Apuntaros.
Aloha, my name is Richard Emery, host of Condo Insider. More than a third of Hawaii's population live in some form of association, and our show is all about educating board members and owners about their responsibilities and obligations and providing solutions for a great association. You can watch me live on Thursdays, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. each week. Aloha.
And we're back here on Likeable Science here on ThinkTech Hawaii. I'm your host, Ethan Allen. Thanks for joining us again on a Friday afternoon. With me today in the ThinkTech studios is Dr. Sonia Rowley from the Department of Geology and Geophysics at UH Manoa and from AME, the Association for Marine Exploration. And we were getting into the differences. She studies Gorgonian corals, which are a special group of corals that differ in terms of their numbers of tentacles, you were saying, and also in the way they build exoskeletons, I guess.
So yes, Gorgonians typically have a central axis, and so that makes them, you know, they look like a sea fan, a tree.
Okay.
Now, one of the things that we were talking about before the break is that some of the species are zooxanthellate. So that means that they have photosynthetic algae within their soft tissue, just like the hard corals that you see in the shallows.
Right.
So one of the things I wanted to bring to your attention was some work that I conducted in Indonesia. So I have a figure on that. And so here is something called Isis hippuris. And it's called horse tail. And basically, there's if you look at the top pictures there, you see what is known as what we would consider a very healthy reef. You can see the surface, there's no strange activity, it's just gorgeous. And that's the phenotype, that's what the Isis hippuris looks like. Now, on the bottom part of this figure, you will see a reef, which is a few kilometers away, which has what we call a Bajau village, which is sea gypsy village in Indonesia. And that's because they live off the sea and put their wastewater in the sea, over the years, what has happened is the reef has degraded. Mm-hmm. And this is also confounded a little bit because the actual reef here is semi-lagoonal. So it's not looking very exciting, is it?
Right.
And so actually the Isis hippuris phenotype that we call that grows on these degraded reefs looks quite different, doesn't it? That's
right.
Supposed to be the same species.
Huh. Looks sort of bushier in a way.
Absolutely,
a
yeah.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely. So it looks quite different. So when I was in the first part of when I was conducting my PhD, I was doing a bunch of ecology where I was looking at all the different Gorgonians, mm-hmm. which, my goodness, that would keep me off the streets for the rest of my life. There's mm-hmm. so many Gorgonians, it's unbelievable. And but I did notice this abundance of this species and how it changed across this environmental gradient.
So you'll see intermediate types as you move from very pristine water into slightly clouded water and very
yeah it was
water. Okay
yeah
it's changing gradually okay
it was changing but I mean when you looked at one and the other, I mean it really was night and day,
right.
And I thought, well, what's going on, you know, are we dealing with two different species,
right.
here? When I looked in the taxonomic records, I have a big thing about going off to museums and checking out all their stuff. I've been all over the place. It's
sure.
fascinating, this history tour that you go in, and Anyway, I'll digress on that. So I thought, right, okay, well, what are the mechanisms of this change? You know, are we, as I say, dealing with two different species? And when I looked in the museum records, they seemed to be suggesting that they were what we call very plastic. You know, they can change quite easily. So I thought, okay, all right, so if we're dealing with the same thing, what if I put them in a completely different, if I swap them, if I grab some from the impacted site, mm-hmm. And I put them in the healthy site, and I grab some in the healthy site, and I put them in the impacted site, and measure as many variables as I possibly can mm-hmm. about both the corals themselves, their symbiodinium, and the environment. Mm-hmm. So that's what I did, and I did that over a couple of years. Right. And what I actually found, you see, this sea gypsy, Bajau village, has been there for probably about 100 years now. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't sound too long. Now, sea gypsy, they used to just travel around. And the theory, the custom is that when somebody dies, then they up and move somewhere else, okay? Uh-huh. So the reefs in which they live off are always able to, you know, they're not overexploited. Uh-huh. Well, what happened due to political reasons 100 years ago, the Indonesian government ruled that the Bajau villages had to stay in one place so they could be accounted for, long story short. And so they continued to do their practices, but what happened is the reefs become increasingly more exploited.
Sure.
So what happened with the corals, is what I discovered, was that the ones in the healthy reefs do change the way they look to fit the environment. But the ones in the unhealthy reef, when you put them in the healthy environment, they were in an incipient stage of actually speciating into a new species. And this is a very short period of time. So I was like, oh God, you know, they're gonna throw the book at me, you know, scientists. But, you know, did a lot of genetic tests and things like that, and they were actually markedly different.
So there's an asymmetry here that you're talking about.
Yeah.
So, and you're gonna have to, I'm sorry, I'm a little slow here. So you take these ones from a good, healthy, clean environment, and you put them in, and they start bushing out and start looking like and behaving like the ones that have been there.
Yes, but some of them died as well. They didn't. Okay. They couldn't take it.
Some couldn't take it, but yeah. Others did. But they were still very clearly not speciating. They're just being a different form.
They were plastic. They were adapting to their environment.
So now, but some of the ones that you took out of the more polluted, the more exploited environment, and put in these pristine environments, how did you know they were changing species or incipiently changing species?
Well, basically, when I put them into the healthy environment, they didn't change.
They just
carried on looking like they would if they were in the unpleasant environment.
Okay.
And also I did genetic analyses as well on the actual coral itself.
Okay.
And that genetic analysis showed me that actually there were a fair few base pair differences to the ones in the healthy environment, and actually all around the local regime. So those in the unhealthy environment were actually starting to become, divergent slightly.
Okay, we're going to take a brief break here. We'll be right back on Likeable Science.
Aloha, I'm Kaui Lucas, host of Hawaii is My Mainland, here on ThinkTech Hawaii every Friday at 3 p.m. We address issues of importance for those of us who live here on the most isolated landmass on the planet. Please come join me Fridays at 3 p.m. Mahalo.
Aloha, my name is Carl Campagna. I am the host of ThinkTech Hawaii's Education Movers, Shakers, and Reformers. You can see our show every Wednesday at noon at 12 p.m. on thinktechhawaii.com, as well as visiting YouTube and finding the link for the show there. The show is also aired on OC16. We look forward to seeing you on the show. We have many wonderful guests, including Joan Husted, Corey Rosenlee, where we talk about the very important issues of education for our keiki. We look forward to seeing you there. Mahalo.
You're watching ThinkTech Hawaii, meeting people we may not otherwise have met, helping us understand and appreciate the good things about Hawaii. Great content for Hawaii from ThinkTech.
And you're back here on Likeable Science. I'm your host, Ethan Allen, here on ThinkTech Hawaii. With me today in the ThinkTech studios is Dr. Sonia Rowley from the University of Hawaii at Manoa, and also from AME, the Association for Marine Exploration. And we've been talking about Gorgonians, a fascinating group of corals that have lots of similarities to it. They are indeed corals, but they also have some very interesting features that many corals do not have. And we were talking about some of these do not have, some of them do not have the little algae that everyone sort of thinks of as being critical components of the coral, the parts of the reef corals that get thrown out during coral bleaching events and cause the corals to sort of collapse and die, right? But some of these deeper ones don't have these.
No, some of the deeper ones don't. And I just wanted to show, I have a figure of some of the examples of some of the Gorgonians that you find in the twilight zone.
Okay.
And so this is in Ponape and Ant Atoll, Pakin Atoll in the Federated States of Micronesia. And these are down to about 140 meters, nearly sort of like, you know, 480 feet or something like that. And as you can see, the dominant group here are the Gorgonians. Oh, and yes. And they're quite biodiverse. And then there's a picture at the bottom there, Anella reticulata, which is a personal favorite of mine, which I'm doing some experiments on right now. It's just fascinating on how they're able to look the way they are, and not just about water flow. Mm-hmm. This was my current area of primary research, is actually working out, their abundance, their diversity. You know, what species are we looking at? Typically new ones. Mm-hmm. My colleagues, Dr. Richard Pyle and Brian Green, they collect the fish, and we all go down together and go and find new species to science. So I have got a video which I'll show you in a bit about that, and you can see some live footage of some of the things that we see.
Sure. Why don't we take a look at that?
Right, okay, yeah, sounds great.
Excellent. So, oops. Oh, this is a... Thank you. Well, that's a trip to a very different world. And
it is.
And what's striking there...
I rolled a die and got two.
What's striking there is the fact that this makes up actually quite an extensive area, right? Because all of our islands that we think about are really just the tips of mountains, basically, in the ocean. Mm-hmm. And what you're exploring are sort of the much bigger slope areas, right? The lower slopes, as it were, mm-hmm. which, of course, by their very nature, then, geometrically, cover much more area. So these are very important large-scale ecosystems. These aren't just little fluky spots.
Exactly. Right. Exactly. I mean, they are huge.
Right.
I mean, it's vast. When you go down there, and the viz is typically really good, especially on the oceanic islands and atolls mm-hmm. compared to continental regions, mm-hmm. It's like, damn my, physiological limitations. Mm-hmm. I just want to go down more and more and more and just see there's just so much stuff. And I've mentioned about the biodiversity, and there's a really good... expeditions that are going on over the current months. I think there's the final leg coming up in the summer of Oceanus, and it's NOAA, and they're showing the ROV footage from, say, around the Marianas.
Okay.
And the reason why I bring that up is because they're going to, say, like 200 meters down to, a few thousand. And when they're up in what they would think the shallow ones, mm-hmm. I'm seeing some of the rare species that I find in the twilight zone, vast fields of them uh-huh. at around 200-300 meters that I can't get to. Mm-hmm. And this is tremendously exciting because uh-huh. then that you understand how another element of how that species came about. And it's like, and also it's like a sense of belonging. It's like, look, everyone, really, look, they're there, seriously, this is what we see. But as you can see there from that video, you'll see, as you say, slopes, but also sheer walls. Mm-hmm. I mean, really, it's quite remarkable.
Right.
And the Gorgonians are just hanging out, and then the fishes are all intertwined within the branches. A lot of them, you've got food fishes that are growing up, okay. Acting as nurseries, and then the other much smaller ones that are very fascinating to aquarists, mm-hmm. that are well camouflaged within the branches.
So this then brings back this whole issue is how these reefs or how these ecosystems are tied to the shallow ones, and if the shallow ones get injured and damaged and the corals up there die, is going to have an impact on these deeper corals.
Right, yes. I mean, there's that is certainly a consideration, and there's a growing body of research that involves the connectivity between shallow and deeper reefs.
Okay.
And there's hypotheses such as what they call the refugia hypothesis. And so hoping that corals, like hard corals in the twilight zone or mesophotic zone, that will reseed the shallower waters. But you are dealing with often different species and different physiologies. Mm-hmm. But then some species are quite remarkable as well, and they can span great depths. That is an ongoing research concern, mm-hmm. and that's really good. But when it comes to the impacts on the deeper reefs, then yes, they are. It's just because you can't see it doesn't mean it's not real.
Right, doesn't mean it's not important, too.
Exactly. And I do have a slide, a photo of some of the human impacts. And here's some from the Philippines. I noticed that the human impacts are much more considerable when you go to continental regions, especially those that are built up. So the ones on the side there is Richard Pyle and Brian Green trying to find fish amongst silt. Mm-hmm. It's quite entertaining. The viz is not that good after a very short time. And then you've got little shrimps, crustaceans, and gorgonians living amongst trash. And then the picture up on the side there, you've got fouling there because the fishing net and stuff is all hung on. I've got tons of photos mm-hmm. like that. It is depressing, but it is real. Mm-hmm. I see less evidence of this anthropogenic impact, if at all, on the remote islands and atolls.
Sure.
And mainly because you haven't got the human population. well, not including here, I suppose, but right. when you go off into the across the Pacific and the South Pacific Islands.
Right, yeah.
It's if very
you're around,
different.
Yeah, if you have only 10,000 people living across a rather extended group of islands,
yeah.
And not a lot of big heavy industry or anything to.
Quite.
Yeah. Yes.
But that also we're dealing with the ocean chemistry, which you've also you've touched on, and the temperature.
Mm-hmm.
And some species, there's some experiments I'm running right now in the field, seem to be very insensitive to temperature. It's mind-blowing, actually. I find it quite fascinating. I want to know how they do it.
Right.
And those, I suspect, will be what we would call the winners.
Okay.
But then there's other species that are hugely temperature sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
And just as the hard corals in the surface, I should imagine, so will the deeper ones start to perish. But they have a much greater depth variance.
Right.
You have a very small percentage of actually a reef, which is actually the coral reef, think to 30, 40 meters.
Mm-hmm.
There's, a couple of hundred when you start looking in the twilight zone.
Okay.
And yeah, so I think that the ocean buffering will have a better chance. It's hard.
Mm-hmm.
It's such a big subject area, but also Gorgonian itself, the protonaceous structure, it survives very well in acidic environments.
Oh, okay, well, that's a point in its favor for the future as the pH of the ocean continues to plunge.
Exactly. And then you have the ocean cycles that have gone on over the millennia and the various thousands of years where the sea level cycles have gone up and down and up and down. And that's usually around 130 meter range.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what we've noticed is when you get down to say like 140 meters and below, so when we start touching at 500 feet, you do see a distinct faunal break again. And it's like, these are the species that have not been exposed.
Never gotten to the surface, basically.
Quite.
They've always been more like deep water corals.
Yeah.
Whereas others have had to, at various points in geologic history, deal with being shallow water corals. And
yeah, they've had a different
right.
Impact. They've had different considerations,
right.
for want of a better word.
Huh.
Yeah.
So that's fascinating. And I know there's very interesting work going on with Dr. Mary Hagedorn, you probably know, on freezing coral egg sperm and embryos to try to preserve some of these species.
Yeah.
But I don't know how much she's gotten into the Gorgonians at all. I think maybe she's mainly been working with the reef coral, but I don't know how many of the deeper species she's ever gotten to.
I think that's an open science.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it would be very interesting because they have been been around for hundreds and thousands of years. You know, well, I think they're not quite Precambrian, but they're close.
Uh-huh.
So that's a lot older than the Scleractinians. But
right.
then the Scleractinians, the hard corals, provide a basis for so many resources for humans,
right.
and you can't deny that by any stretch of the imagination.
Right.
So they are of an immediate.
Right.
Concern,
yeah.
but it would be good.
Yeah.
It would be great.
Yes, the picture of resiliency that you painted is at least a cheerful note there, or a hopeful note, I should say.
Absolutely. There's one slide I just wanted to bring to your attention.
Sure.
Actually, I was mentioning about the Okeanos. So we bring up that figure if you get the chance. And so, as you can see here, this is what we find, nearly 5,000 meters is a can of BAM.
Oh, wow.
And 25% less sodium, of course, so that's okay. So, humans, we get everywhere.
Yes.
we get everywhere. Yes. I just thought that would be good, out of sight, out of mind, apparently.
No, it's very true. I mean, I was reading recently of a group who went around and did core samples from the seafloor everywhere from the very north from the Arctic
mm-hmm.
down through the Atlantic and the Mediterranean through the South Atlantic over into the Indian Ocean, and all of these core samples have little plastic microbeads and little polyester fibers at quite high concentrations,
mm-hmm.
Surprisingly high concentrations, which
mm-hmm.
means our human detritus, at least on a micro scale, is everywhere in the world now. In every ecosystem, the little filter feeders are eating it, and
yeah.
God knows what impact that's having on them.
It's quite remarkable, really. It really, really is.
So you do some interesting education and outreach work, too, to help get some of the local people more informed about their parts of their environment they don't see, right?
Yes.
Tell us about this here.
Yeah, so part of what we do, I mean, you can't keep what you have without giving it away. Mm-hmm. I love that phrase, it's so true. There's no point in us scuttling away with our data and, you know, and trying to just publish it in academic journals and so on and so forth. Good as that is, mm-hmm. It needs to be useful.
Right.
It needs to be useful across the board. And so when we go to wherever we go, there was a picture there, you saw me with Sonirek. Sonirek is the chief of Pakin, which is a remote atoll off Ponape. It sports a population of 80 people, mm-hmm. and I've never been in such a clean village in my life. Really, it blew my mind, and the people were fantastic. They really were. And they opened us into the fold. We went in. They got one generator that was given to them a few years ago. They booted that up, put out a table, stuck the light on me and the specimens, and basically the whole community came in and were with me until like midnight, processing these specimens. We were counting the brittle stars on them. They were fascinated. They've actually actively work with the local conservation community conservation societies to have MPAs around their atoll. Mm-hmm. And they're very much engaged on what their reefs are like. And we mm-hmm. give them all the footage. You'll be surprised, there's iPads on there or something in my mind. I was like, but it was amazing. But wherever we go, we do give it back into the community. So look, here's all our data, here's all our footage and images. Take it, use it if it's useful, you know, and we go and speak to people, to the schools, all those things, excellent. And write blogs and everything.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah, I know you've got great stuff up on your AME site, but you got to do that. It's fascinating. These small island communities, in many cases, are very conscious of their environment, living on it. Mm-hmm. I suspect a small island makes you very conscious of just what your limitations are, how much water you have, how much space you have for food, mm-hmm. what happens if a bad storm comes through, how interdependent you are on your neighbors, how interdependent you are with the ocean around you, and so they're probably quite receptive to your work, because you're showing them essentially what lies just beyond the edge of where they can go, and yet they understand there's more out there. They know their islands don't just sort of float in the middle of nothing. They understand their islands have a large base. Yeah,
and of course, with sea level rising, you know, low-lying islands and atolls, it's not looking good.
Anyhow, we are just about out of time. However, this has been a fascinating conversation. Maybe the last thing here, the Hawaiian seamounts.
Oh, yes, there's a project we're on next year in 2017 in the University of Hawaii with Professor Les Watling and amongst others. And we'll be going out discovering the various faunal breaks along the Hawaiian Emperor Seamount chain. So we're studying the octocorals, the Gorgonians there, really, really deep on the seamounts and the guyotes. And so keep your eyes peeled on that. We've got some real seminal science going on.
These will be where a species comes along and then sort of stops and another species takes over the next.
Yes, we'll be doing that with the Schmidt Institute, and what we're seeing is there is a faunal break, and we're looking at the different water bodies in order to answer various questions on why we're seeing the patterns that we're seeing. So again, Gorgonians, they traverse the depths. To me, they're fascinating. I learn something new every day. Case closed.
You've certainly taught me, and I hope our audience something new today, many, many new things, actually, and it's been a real pleasure having you here. I very much appreciate you being my guest. Dr. Sonia Rowley from the Manoa and the Association for Marine Exploration. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much indeed.